Hi, and welcome to another episode of Kidzone Online. Tonight we've got another look at God's book and another new memory verse from the Bible. And we've got a new voice this evening. Matthew's going to bring us the story, looking again at events surrounding the death of the Lord Jesus. And he's going to be dealing with the trial of the Lord Jesus and how the Lord Jesus was brought before two very important people. And of course, as usual, we've got some singing. So without anything further, let's get on with some singing. Now, we've not sung this one for a while. After all this home learning, I don't know whether you're back at school yet or whether you'll be going back next week, but we'd better remember the alphabet and think about that together. A, B, C, D, E, F, G. Jesus died for you and me. Thinking again about the death of the Lord Jesus on Calvary's tree, he died for me. Why did he die for me? That I his love might know. To set me free, he died for me. You know, the Lord Jesus died to take my place. And he died to take my sins and the punishment for my sins, the things that I've done wrong. And I wonder if we can all sing this from the heart, to say and to realize that when the Lord Jesus died, he died for me. That's why I love him so. Now, we sang this one last week after a while not singing it. Wounded for me, there on the cross. He, that's the Lord Jesus, was wounded for me. Now let's sing this one. He paid a debt he did not owe. I owed a debt I could not pay. I needed someone to wash my sins away. And the Lord Jesus paid the debt that I could never pay.
Amazing grace, the whole day long.
Back to some spelling now then. What does H-A-P-P-Y spell? It spells happy. And what does S-A-V-E-D spell? Saved. And what does L-O-V-E-D spell? It spells loved. And as we ask so often on Kids at Kidzone, what's the one that absolutely everybody can say? Well, that is that we're loved, that God loves us. Well, we might not be happy all the time. We might not even be saved. It would be wonderful if everyone who's watching was saved, if they knew their sins forgiven and knew that the Lord Jesus was their saviour and on the way to heaven. But you know, if we can get it into our heads that every one of us is loved by God, that would be wonderful. Prayer time now, so let's do the prayer drill. Let's go 1, 2, 3. Father, again, we just give thee thanks that we can come together like this for another episode of Kidzone Online. And we give thanks again that we can think about the Lord Jesus. And we can think about the one who died on the cross to save us. We thank you, Father, that we can sing about him. We thank you, Father, that we can sing about one who paid a debt that he didn't owe. So that we who owed a debt that we couldn't pay might be forgiven, might have our sins cleansed, and might be made ready and fit for heaven. Now, Father, we do thank thee that we can be happy and we can be saved. But our Father, we do thank thee that we are all loved by thee. Help us to understand that. Help us to understand just how greatly the Lord Jesus loved us to die for us on the cross of Calvary. So, Father, we just ask thee for thy help. Bless us as we spend this time together, for we ask it in the name of the Lord Jesus. Amen. Let's sing this one now. And don't forget the actions. God's love is the best love that the world has ever, ever known. See how deep you can go and how high you can go and how wide you can go. Because God's love is the best love the world could ever and will ever know. Quick look at God's book now. Remember what God's book is called? That's right, it's the Bible. Now, the Bible gives us different descriptions, different pictures of what it's like. And so, for example, we can think of some of them together tonight. It says that the Bible's like a hammer. Well, that's the kind of hammer that we use to build things up, isn't it? But it's really like a sledgehammer that breaks the rock in pieces. And you know, the Bible, it takes hard hearts. It takes hearts that are stubborn and unwilling, and it breaks them down and it softens them. And it helps us to see just what God has done for us. But it's not just like a hammer, it's like a flashlight. You know, when you shine a torch out on a dark night, how many steps ahead does it show? Does it show a long, long way? Well, I suppose it depends on how bright the torch is, but usually a little flashlight, it'll show you the step, maybe one step, maybe two steps in front. And that's what the Bible's like, you know. The Bible is like a guide. It's like a flashlight. And God guides those who trust in him. And he guides them one step at a time. But the Bible's also like a lighthouse. You know what a lighthouse does? Well, a lighthouse shines its light and it warns of danger. It says, don't come near me because there's rocks here. If you're in a boat and you come near me, you're likely to be wrecked. And the Bible's like a lighthouse. It tells us of danger. It tells us of our sins. It tells us of the fact that we'll be punished for our sins if we don't have them forgiven. And it warns us and it tells us to trust in the Lord Jesus. The Bible is also like a mirror. What happens when you look in the mirror? Well, you see yourself. And you see yourself as you really are. You know, sometimes when you look at yourself in the morning and you've just got up, it's not a pretty sight, is it? And sometimes when we look in the mirror, we'll maybe do our hair. Or we'll do other things. We might find some dirt, or if we've been eating tomato soup, we might find some tomato soup still around our mouth, and we might look in the mirror and we might clean it up. You see, we find out what needs to be changed and we make changes. Now, the Bible does that. The Bible shows us how we really are. You know, you don't look at the Bible to feel good about yourself, because the Bible tells us that we're sinners and it tells us that we need to change. And the Bible tells us that there's things about our life that don't please God, but the Bible also tells us about the Lord Jesus. And it shows us the Lord Jesus and shows us the one who can change us and make us into what God wants us to be. But lastly, the Bible's also like a sword. And you know what a sword does? A sword will prick you. Sure, a sword's got a very sharp point, hasn't it? And it just goes in and it slices through things. And the Bible, it gets right to the heart, you know. And it pricks us right in our hearts. And it tells us the things that we should be doing. And it tells us about the Lord Jesus. And it tells us about our sin. And it pricks our hearts. And we realize that we need to do something about it. I wonder if the Bible has been pricking your heart, and if the Bible stories and the things that we've been telling you at Kidzone have been pricking your hearts and telling you that you need to change, telling you that you need a saviour, telling you that you need the Lord Jesus. Well, don't ignore it. Listen and trust the Lord Jesus as your saviour. Let's sing this one. Joy is a flag flown high from the castle of my heart. When the king, who's the king? Well, it's the Lord Jesus. And what does it mean to be in residence? That means to be staying there, to have the Lord Jesus staying in my heart, because my trust is in him as my saviour. Time for a memory verse now. Now, last week we looked at all the memory verses that we've done over the past few weeks. We're going to look at one or two of them again this evening, just the more recent ones, and then we're going to learn a new one together. So let's start with this one. The words of the Lord Jesus. Love your enemies. Do good to them that hate you. Luke chapter 6, verse 27. Let's try it while the words are disappearing. You ready? Love your enemies, do good to them that hate you. Luke chapter 6, verse 27. And then the big long one that we did. You ready? Let's try it all together. Big deep breath. Are you ready? For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. Romans chapter 1, verse 16. And again then, you should be getting quite good at this one now because we've done it a few times. But while the words are disappearing, you ready? For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. Romans chapter 1, verse 16. Now this week's, this is written by Peter, as you can find it's in the first letter that, that Peter wrote, that's why it's called 1 Peter, in chapter 2 and verse 22, talking about the Lord Jesus, it said, who did no sin, never did anything wrong, neither was guile found in his mouth. Guile is deceit and lying. The Lord Jesus never, ever told a lie. But he didn't even tell the truth in a way that was going to fool people or deceive people. You know, we can do that. We can tell half-truths, or we can tell the truth in such a way we can say something that's true, but we can actually be meaning something else. The Lord Jesus never did that either. He did no sin. Neither was guile found in his mouth. So let's say it a few times together. You ready? Who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 22. And again, who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 22. One last time before the words disappear. You ready? Who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 22. Right, now see how many times you can say it while the words are disappearing. On your marks, get set, go. And one last time, all together, you ready? Who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 22. And we'll learn another one from Peter and from 1 Peter chapter 2 next week. How many ways are there to heaven? Well, that's right, there's only one. And who is the way to heaven? Well, it's the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the only Saviour. And he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father, no one comes to God except through me. Story time now. Over to you, Matthew.
Well, good evening, boys and girls. As Simon said, it's now story time, and I am delighted to be telling you the story this week. Before we get started, let's look back at last week's story to quickly remind us of what happened and to help set the scene. Last week, Simon told us of the betrayal of the Lord Jesus by one of his very own disciples or followers, Judas Iscariot. If you remember, the religious leaders were really angry and jealous with the Lord Jesus because he showed them up for the people they really were. They were power hungry. They were hypocrites. They told the people to do one thing while they did another. They were only concerned with how they looked in their standing in society. They used Judas Iscariot to help find the Lord Jesus and secretly arrest him at night. And last week, the story finished with the Lord Jesus bound in ropes and being taken away. Well, this week we are going to look at what happened next and the trial of the Lord Jesus. If you want to follow the message or look back at it, you can find it in the New Testament part of the Bible and in the first book, the book of Matthew. And the bit we're going to be looking at is in chapter 26 from verse 57 right through to chapter 27 verse 26. We're not covering all the verses, but we're going to be looking specifically at the trial of the Lord Jesus. Well, as we covered earlier, the Lord Jesus was bound in ropes and led away, and the plotters took him to one of the most important men in the country, a man called Caiaphas, the high priest, so they could put him on trial and accuse him of wrongdoing, a bit like they do in a court today. When they took him there, all the priests and the scribes and the elders, the most important people in the land, were already gathered. You may think this is strange. Why would they all be gathered already this late at night? But remember, boys and girls, this was a plot that they had pre-planned to try and capture the Lord Jesus and sentence him to death. When on trial before Caiaphas, they brought forward lots of witnesses. The Bible calls them false witnesses because they told lies and made up stories about the Lord Jesus so they could make up a reason to put him to death because, remember, they hated him. The Bible tells us that although many false witnesses came forward, they couldn't agree one with the other because they were all telling lies. The Lord Jesus was blameless and sinless. He had done nothing wrong, not one thing. Caiaphas, the chief priest, asked the Lord Jesus if he was Christ, the Son of God. The Lord Jesus replied, "You have said so, but I tell you, from now on you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven." This enraged the chief priest, as he saw this as blasphemy. They did not see the Lord Jesus as God. He tore his clothes. He was so angry, and he said that the Lord Jesus Christ should be put to death. Do you know what they did next, boys and girls? So this is awful. They spat on his face, they punched his face and slapped him, and they said, "Tell us, Christ, who was it that hit you?" How do you think he felt when his own creation, who he had come to save, did this to him? Remember, boys and girls, the Lord Jesus came to this earth to save us from our sins. This reminds us of how much the Lord Jesus loved us in coming and going through this despite knowing all this would happen beforehand. All these people, including the chief priest, then retired for the night. And then in the morning, all the chief priests and the elders, they then took the Lord Jesus to Pilate, so Pilate could also put him on trial. Pilate was the Roman governor. Remember, at this time, the Romans controlled the land, and Pilate was the governor in charge. Pilate then decided to question the Lord Jesus. He asked him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" And the Lord Jesus said, "You have said so." And after saying that, he didn't answer any more questions or answer any of the other unjust accusations from the false witnesses. Pilate was amazed. He had not seen anything like this before. Now, at this time of the year, there was a feast in the land, and the Roman governor usually released one prisoner that the crowd wanted. One of the prisoners they had was a man called Barabbas. Barabbas was an evil and very well-known criminal. He was notorious throughout the land. When everyone had gathered, Pilate asked him, "Who do you want me to release, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Christ?" Pilate maybe thought they would surely not pick a notorious criminal and that he would be able to release the Lord Jesus. He knew that the chief priests and the elders had delivered the Lord Jesus to him because they were envious of him and jealous of him. Pilate's wife had also had a dream and had sent a message to Pilate saying, "Have nothing to do with this righteous man, for I have suffered much because of him today," in a dream. While this was all going on, the chief priests and the elders, filled with hatred and jealousy, persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and to destroy the Lord Jesus, so that when Pilate asked which of the two should be released, they cried, "Barabbas." When asked what he should do with the Lord Jesus, they all said, "Let him be crucified." When asked why, what has he done, they had no answer. They just cried, "Let him be crucified." This is awful, isn't it, boys and girls? The Lord Jesus had only done good to the people. He had healed the sick and helpless, and he had come down to save the people, yet they rejected him. When Pilate could see he was gaining nothing, but that there was potential for a riot, because they were all still shouting, "Let him be crucified," he took water and washed his hands before the crowd, and he said, "I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves." The people then cried an awful thing. They cried, "His blood be on us and on our children." Then Pilate released Barabbas, and when his soldiers had scourged or whipped the Lord Jesus, he delivered him to be put to death. Isn't that awful? So today, boys and girls, we've looked at the trial of the Lord Jesus before Caiaphas and then before Pilate. And now I want to look at what are the key lessons that we can learn from this story, from the story this week. Point number one is, let's not be jealous and ever lie about someone else, like the chief priests and the elders. Remember, God is always watching us. The second point is the sinlessness of the Lord Jesus. He was blameless. Nobody could point a finger at him. Even when they planned to accuse him, the false witnesses couldn't find one thing they could agree that he had done wrong. The third thing is not to follow the crowd. Remember, the crowd all wanted him crucified. If you want to be a Christian, it is not popular. You have to do it alone, and people may mock you like they mocked the Lord Jesus. In fact, they most likely will. And finally, let us not forget, this is the main point, let us not forget the love the Lord Jesus had, and that he was willing to go through all of these trials, all of this rejection, all of the physical and mental abuse to bring about our salvation. Remember, boys and girls, he went to the cross for our sins. He bore the punishment that we deserved. And in order to become a Christian or a follower of Christ, we must say sorry to God for the bad things that we have done, for the sins that we've committed, and we must trust in the Lord Jesus for our salvation and acknowledge that when he died on the cross, he died for us. And that is this week's story, boys and girls. Thanks for listening. And remember to watch next week's story time to find out what happens next.
Well, thanks for joining us for another episode of Kidzone Online. Thanks to freebibleimages.org for the pictures, and to Cedar One Kids for the theme tune. And again, as usual, we say if you want to get in contact with us, the email address is contact@innerlevengospelhall.org.uk, or you'll find us on Facebook at Innerleven Gospel Hall. Please leave a message, let us know that you're watching, and until next time, may God bless you.